If you've discovered that your property has a BAL 40 or a BAL flame zone rating on it in terms of its bushfire attack level, that can feel a bit overwhelming and a bit nerve-wracking, because many people will tell you that's just going to mean it's going to cost a heck of a lot extra in order to build or renovate. But there are specific things to know and ways that you can navigate this to simplify the process overall. This video is part of our Rebuild and Build Better series. So be sure to like the video, subscribe to Undercover Architects YouTube channel, and hit the bell so that you're always notified when a new video is published. Understanding the implications of a BAL 40 or a BAL flame zone rating on your property and what that might mean for material selections, the type of design that you can choose, and what you have to do for the landscape around it. All of these things are key so that you can factor them in during your design stage. Knowing holistically what you can do and what you might be able to balance off in terms of decisions about what you invest in your home versus what you invest in supporting infrastructure, all of this can be part of your solution to help your property be more resistant and resilient during the event of a bushfire. In this video, we go into more information, particularly in relation to BAL 40 and BAL flame zone, and what you can do to navigate this scenario should this be the rating on your property. Hello, I'm Amelia Lee from Undercover Architect, and I help and teach homeowners how to get it right when designing, building, and renovating their family homes. In this video, I speak with Jeff Dau from Ember Bushfire Consulting. Ember Bushfire Consulting are a team of qualified, accredited professionals in the fire industry, and Jeff himself, as co-founder, has over 28 years' experience as a professional in the fire industry. He shares a huge wealth of knowledge and information when it comes to understanding the impacts that a bushfire overlay can have on your property and how you need to navigate building and renovating in one of these types of areas.
I can imagine you get a lot of pushback from people saying, oh, it's just going to be so much more expensive. Do I seriously need to do this? Particularly if a BAL 40 or a BAL flame zone rating comes in, that can be a horrendous shock to people when they start to see what that might mean. How do you talk through clients in terms of, I know that you've had a client who had a property that didn't have a building on it that went through the recent fires, and they're now kind of considering how are they going to actually build on that property to be better performing. How do you kind of, once you deliver your assessment, how do you talk through clients that process of, okay, this is the scenario, but this is actually the opportunity?
So I think the hardest part is that when I look at a site, I see a particular, you know, I very much try to visualize what it's like on a bad day and trying to relay that to the client. And they obviously, what is the threat? I don't see any threat here. You know, like it hasn't burned in 50 years. It's not going to burn again. So that's, you know, they're not seeing what I see. And that's often the hardest part of it. Even in like in a grassland setting, it's an empty paddock, for goodness sakes. But we know that grass fires can still be very, very destructive, very dangerous. So that's the first part, is that, you know, why do I have to do this? I think that argument now is becoming less and less, like we can just see that we're vulnerable and more areas are vulnerable. So that's less hard. But what I do try to do, obviously, again, if there's opportunity to move, and this is, again, the planning system working, push you to areas where it's a lower BAL rating, so it's safer. It's also less to build. So that's the response. Luckily, the places that I've assessed where they haven't built yet, that BAL rating wasn't that high. The trick will be, as I said, in these spots where it was always flame zone, the house is 40, 50 years old or older, and now they have to rebuild. But I think if it's been burnt out, then the argument, you know, speaks for itself, I think. But it is going to be very hard, you know, just being straight up, it's going to be hard for some people to deal with that 40 and flame zone, and also councils, whether they let people rebuild. But I don't think that's going to be the case. You know, Rosedale will still continue to be built, but they'll have some pretty tough ones there. But what I would say is that it is what it is. You know, let's don't try to duck and weave. And it's when we duck and weave that it ends poorly from a planning and a DA point of view, because they can see that you're trying to avoid that. The council doesn't want to, you know, sort of have a bar that they don't want to have ownership in under constructing or building in places that you probably shouldn't build. don't be fearful of it. Get good advice, and then, you know, and listen to that advice as well. But don't. I think as soon as we start to avoid, then that's when you start to run into trouble, or put it on the shelf. Oh, we'll deal with that later. That's when it really hurts, because then you have to retrofit all that design that you've had that hasn't taken into account. It's all of a sudden, you know, you're going to lose all your timber facade or your timber deck. It's gone. So get in early.
Yeah, and I think that's the key thing, isn't it, that if you actually understand these assessments and ratings up front early and can factor them into your design process, then it's not a budget shock down the track. It's actually creating a different strategy. And I think that's going to be key for rebuilding in a lot of these areas, that you're not necessarily just replicating what you had before, but you're actually using it as an opportunity to strategize something different and something that's much more resilient. Can you perhaps, just with the BAL 40 and the BAL flame zone, the BAL FZ, could you just talk through some of the detail of what that can mean for the construction of a property, and also, I suppose, other strategies that can come into play? You touched on bunkers. I had heard that somebody was able to, in a recent project, they were able to include a bunker, and that gave them some leeway in the construction of the property itself. How can BAL 40 and BAL flame zone be, I suppose, approached, and what kind of strategies can you use to get good results in the in those kind of ratings of areas?
Well, I think the first thing is that so BAL 40 and flame zone, absolutely no combustibles at all. So timber's off the shelf altogether. That said, you can use like mod wood for decking, and any number of other products that you know, still are reasonably visually appealing. So that's, I guess, that's the first thing. As I said, there's more and more products that are becoming available. And then flame zone, it gets up there. One of the recent changes has been the shutters. So in 3959, if you you can, and certainly New South Wales, you can use shutters. So you can go for a good traditional sort of window set if it's protected by a appropriately rated shutter. So that opens up some opportunities, and I can kind of hear people saying, "Well, yeah, but the shutters are ugly." Yes, but there are ways of, you know, putting it within the reveal. There are ways to address that. So there's a little thing there. You said shutters can, and that can also reduce the price, particularly if you're in the flame zone area. There's some benefit there. Going on to, so that's the 40 in flame zone. Going on to the bunkers is it's an area of kind of new work. There's only recently a standard that came in. At the moment, I can only speak to New South Wales. I know in Victoria, where from what I heard through the industry, is that where you were flame zone, if you put in a bunker that was built to the standard, then you could possibly come down a BAL rating. So that, I think that they do. Again, I think there'll be improvement here. New South Wales RFS are kind of not sold on it. They certainly not opposed to the idea, but it from my understanding, it's not going to get you any concessions. That said, that, you know, I think that personally, I think they're a great idea. There was a client down in Smith's Road, down in the area adjacent to the ACT. Great, you know, quite an impressive story that the owner of that property had survived, they had survived the 2003 bushfires. Their property didn't. And rather than becoming fearful of it, and I think obviously this took some time, they moved out to the bush. We were in a very bushfire prone area, but it didn't put them off. They accepted the threat, and put a bunker in. And they had everything in place. They knew that they were going to leave early. But the fact that they did that, they, rather than, I guess, running away from this, going, you know what, for 10 years, this place is going to be beautiful every day of the week, you know, and we're going to enjoy this. But if the inevitable does happen at some stage, then we do have a plan B, which was this bunker. And I was very impressed by that attitude. And I think it was quite cheap too. I think it was between 10 and 15 grand, and, you know, that's a fantastic insurance policy. Their road was about 20k out. It's one way in, one way out. So it is a bushfire, a bushfire prone area, and also many access issues there. So I think, again, to the question, I think bunkers, you will see more in this space, and with a hope that they may offer some concession to these BAL 40 flame zone areas. That's where we hope. But RFS are always sort of adjusting. They do in time. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think it'll be interesting. It was a report that I'd read after the 2009 Victorian fires that had mentioned that thing of somebody was then rebuilding and they were a BAL flame zone, and they were told that, they could spend $15,000 on installing a bunker to standard and then lower the house to BAL 40. It was going to save them about $80,000 overall, because to make the house BAL flame zone was a significantly bigger investment than putting the bunker in and dropping it to BAL 40. So it will be interesting to see if these strategies, there's a lot of contention I hear around bunkers, but I think it's because we have so many that are kind of just DIY built things that mold-ridden, not properly ventilated, not actually fireproof at all, end up being traps for people. So I think that actually to create some legislation around how they're constructed and what they need to be, the standard that they need to be built with in order to be an offset measure, could actually be a huge opportunity to have holistic kind of solutions to dealing with construction in these areas. So it'll be really interesting, won't it?
Yeah, I think so. And I think that's the good that comes out of these not so good events, you know, is that there's these improvements. So, it would be good to see.
Did you find that helpful? I so hope that you did. Make sure that you check out the description below. We've got lots of extra information to help and support you as you build or renovate your home. There's also a full transcript available of this interview, and the link is in the descriptions below. Now, be sure to like the video, subscribe to Undercover Architects YouTube channel, and hit the bell so that you're notified every time a new video is published. And you can be sure to check out these videos as well, because we've got lots of extra information to share with you that's going to be super helpful. As always, thank you for tuning in and for letting me be your secret ally. Until next time, bye.